Okay, good afternoon, everyone. It's a pleasure for me to welcome you to our next talk. It's about deconstructing hardware security, or silicon-based security, demonstrated on the Xbox 360. And I would like to welcome this afternoon Felix Domke and Michael Steil. They're going to brief us through what hardware security is all about, why it is perceived as being so secure, and why it actually is not. Enjoy the talk, and yeah, have a nice day.
Hello, everyone. I'm Michael Stahl, and I'll only do the first few minutes and talk a little about politics, and the rest will be done by Felix. I'm going to make one big point that Linux is inevitable and that companies should just make it possible to run homebrew software or Linux on all these devices. If you've been to the Congress in the last few years, you might have seen many presentations like this one, like for the Xbox, for the GameCube, Wii hacking, PlayStation hacking, also DS hacking. It's always been the same. Someone constructed a security system, wanted to make copies impossible, or wanted to make hacking pay TV impossible, or many other things. And in the end, they locked it down completely. And what happened was that Linux was ported to it, and other things happened that were not as good for it as well, or even worse for it. I've made a small chart about devices in the last 8 years. This is the quality of the security system with all their details. So there are some security systems that were pretty weak. They only have checksums, like the iPod. And there's some of them which are pretty sophisticated. Xbox 360 is the best one of them. This is how long it took hackers to hack them. So GameCube took pretty long because it was one of the first systems hacked, and not many people were interested in that back then. Today, there are so many more people, and the GameCube would be hacked in a lot less time. If you look at the Xbox 360, which is the best one, it took 12 months to hack it, and PlayStation 3, which has not yet been hacked. These are the reasons why they have been hacked. Except for the PlayStation 2 back then, which was just too weak to do anything sensible in terms of media player software or using it as a Linux computer, all the other ones have been hacked to run third-party software on it, like emulators, or to run Linux on it. Except for the PS3. And if you look at the effect, although the intention was to run Linux or homebrew software, there was always that side effect of either pay TV decoding for set-top boxes, or piracy, or in the Xbox 360 case, also piracy, but also leaked keys, which is bad for online gaming. For the Apple TV, they pirated data off that device, and for the iPhone, it's about that whole SimLock revenue thing. The interesting point now is, why is the PS3 different? And the reason is because they released Linux, and they allowed homebrew software. The Linux hackers have not been interested in hacking it. It has not been hacked. And piracy is not possible on that platform. It's the only platform out there where piracy is not possible of all of the major gaming consoles. So the lessons that have to be learned are that the Linux and homebrew hacker guys are the smartest out there. It's not the commercial hackers that make mod chips. It's the enthusiasts. And if they join their forces, most of the times they won't directly join their forces, but one group will do something and the other one can copy those ideas and improve them, then it gets hacked a lot more quickly. And so if there's a Linux camp, then it's two forces that can join. And always look at the collateral damage, like lost keys. You always lose your security system overall if Linux runs on it. So it seems like some companies might have gotten the idea. Microsoft met with some of us recently, and I hope it's going more into that direction, that companies understand that working together with homebrew people and Linux people on these platforms is a good idea. Okay, that was my part. Now over to Felix.
Hi, so I'm Felix Domke, and yeah, let's see it from the eyes of Microsoft. We want to build a gaming console. And we will see that the bad guys, they want piracy. They try to pirate games for our new gaming console, and we, of course, don't want that. Other people will build worms and viruses, maybe. Or yeah, there are like 10 million Xboxes out there, and if you could exploit them and run a worm on them, well, you would have instantly a huge botnet, because all of those boxes run the same software. So this is something you want to protect your gaming console from. Another thing, yeah, okay, now we are Microsoft, so we want to protect our box from that hackers can run Linux on it, because we don't like Linux. So that's another thing. And of course, we want to protect the gamers, because gamers, they have fun when doing games. And if some of the gamers invent cheats and have like some hardware hacks or whatever and can cheat in online games, this is a very bad thing. So, well, just we need security, Microsoft said. But security sounds easy, but isn't easy. Now, if we look at it from the point of view of the hacker, there's a flash ROM where the whole operating system is stored. And that flash ROM, we can solder it out, we can reprogram it, we own the flash ROM. The RAM, yeah, the RAM is high speed and so on, but as we might see later in this talk, even with RAM, we can mess around. So it's not so secure just because it's high speed. The same is true for buses between your chips, like PCI Express or the front side bus. Like you saw on the original Xbox, where Microsoft relied on the bus to be fast enough to not be sniffed. Well, it has been sniffed, the key was leaked, and yeah, now you can run Linux on it without any problems. So sometimes you don't even need to use new hardware. You can use existing hardware, which is in the system, and abuse it. Like, it was quite popular, the FireWire attacks, where you can read out the complete memory of a system using a FireWire port. So this is another point of attack where a hacker could sneak in. Of course, stuff like DVDs, the hard disks, the network, the USB, they are all under the control of the hacker. So, yeah. In fact, everything is under the control of the hacker, maybe. And it can get even worse, because, yeah, games might be the thing which should run on the system, but even games could be malware when the game coder implemented a backdoor in the game and the signing people didn't recognize it. Or they could act like malware, for example, if they can be exploited. So what Microsoft tried on the original Xbox was a chain of trust, where the bootloader checks the signature of the kernel checks the signature of the game, and the game was free to do everything it wanted. And once you have a signed game, the game could own the complete console and, for example, launch Linux. So the chain of trust is a system which definitely doesn't work today, because software is so complex, you cannot ensure that a signed software cannot do anything bad at all. So, yeah, we need something better. So if the hackers own the memory, what could we do? We could encrypt the memory. We could add some hardware which, yeah, takes all the data which is stored into the RAM and encrypted before, and when it gets read back, we decrypt it on the fly. This is quite effective. We cannot snoop the memory anymore, because all we had is encrypted data. Of course, the key must be random enough, but this is possible. But maybe the hackers are already running code, like the backdoor game example or some exploitable game. So we need something to protect from this attack scenario too. So what Microsoft did on the Xbox was to invent a hypervisor. A hypervisor is what a supervisor on your PC. It's basically the same thing. It keeps the user program, the game, under control. So the game on the Xbox 360 cannot do anything it wants. It can only do a limited set of operations. So basically, the hypervisor forms a sandbox and provides some cryptographical stuff. And yeah, the game can talk with most of the hardware directly, but with the security sensitive stuff, it cannot talk directly, but has to ask the hypervisor to do stuff, like to encrypt something with a shared key or decrypt something with a shared key. And this is quite a nice system because an exploit in the game won't exploit the whole console anymore. Of course, if the hypervisor itself can be exploited, this is a different thing. But the hypervisor is quite small. We'll see this later. So, yeah, there is no absolute chain of trust anymore on the Xbox 360. Once a game runs, it runs with limited privileges, like a user mode on your desktop operating system. Of course, if the game has to talk with the GPU for 3D graphics and so on. Effectively, this means that the game can write everywhere at once. There is no such thing like, this is the reason actually why it's a hypervisor, not a supervisor. The game must run in supervisor to be fast, so the data can be exchanged with the GPU fast enough. So, if the game could reload code and into data areas and just jump there, like the game with the backdoor could just load something from USB or whatever, load it in RAM and jump there, this would kill the system because the hacker could just use that backdoor to load new code. To protect against this, you can use non-executable code pages. This is, I think, a standard thing on PCs now. The Xbox CPU does implement non-executable code pages, and it's used everywhere on the Xbox. There is no user-writable code page with an executable as well. So even if a game wants to load data into RAM and execute it, it doesn't work, because only the hypervisor itself can make pages executable or writable. But the hypervisor, of course, will check the signature first. Of course, this doesn't protect against all exploits, because even if you can overwrite the stack, for example, with some stack exploit in a game, you could still jump to any location in system memory. You cannot jump to your own code, because it's not an executable code page, but you can jump to, say, some library function which does what you want, like doing some stuff. So you have to be careful, but it's a step into the right direction, definitely. We talked about the memory encryption. Memory encryption is a nice thing, but sometimes it's not enough. For example, imagine a blacklist stored in memory, which is encrypted. So maybe there was a game which needs to be revoked for whatever reason. So there's a list which stores a hash of the revoked game. And now the hacker wants to load that game. And if the memory would be just encrypted, he could just flip a bit of that encrypted table. If he flips a bit in the encrypted data, after the decryption, it's some random garbage, but it's not the original blacklist anymore. So you need additionally memory checksums or memory hashes. And sometimes you could even insert instructions, for example, a branch instruction in the PowerPC code. Just the first 5 bits indicate that it's a branch instruction, and the rest is a branch target. So if you want to insert a branch into the code, branch wherever, if you don't care where for some exploit, you could do this if the memory is just encrypted with a certain probability, which is high enough to be exploitable. What Microsoft did to defeat this was to implement memory checksums, or memory hashes. It's a real hash, in fact. So certain important areas, like the blacklist stuff, for example, or the hypervisor code, is on the fly transparently hashed when written, and when it's read, the hash is compared to the stored hash. And if the hash doesn't match anymore because the hacker flipped a bit in the memory, then it will hang the system. This is quite effective, and it requires some additional RAM, but that's okay. Another thing, memory encryption, it's easy to say, just encrypt all the memory. But in fact, you have to talk to the GPU, you have to talk to the South Bridge with the Ethernet on USB and so on. And you don't want the USB controller to decrypt your stuff, because the USB controller would need the secret key then. So what you need is selective memory encryption. So certain data should be encrypted and other data should not be encrypted. An easy way to implement this is using the YAML. So if you could have on any data page in memory a bit like encrypted or not. This is exactly what you want. You could encrypt your sensitive stuff, and you could not encrypt your data which goes to the GPU or something. Unfortunately, changing the MMU in a system is not so easy because it's included in the CPU core, and you don't want to change something in the CPU core. For example, the PowerPC core is nearly the same as on the Cell CPU, for example, and you don't want to have risky changes inside the CPU core. So what Microsoft actually did was they had a clever idea of just using a standard memory management unit, and PowerPC 64 MMU, for example, offers 32 bits of physical memory space. So the bits which come out of the address, bits which come out of the MMU, are more than which are required to address all the memory. For example, the Xbox has 512 megabytes of RAM, plus a bit of PCI space and here and that. So with the 4 gig of real address space, that's all you need. So you have some address bits left. And those address bits are used to control the encryption and hashing mechanism. So we see this later because it's important of some hack we attempted. So yeah, but it's actually a very flexible way because you can fully control the encryption in software. And you, yeah, it's transparent to the user space. The hypervisor handles the stuff which should be encrypted or not and set up the page table accordingly. So, but the user space doesn't notice that the memory is encrypted. The encryption, of course, has to take place on the CPU. It doesn't make sense to have it, for example, on the Northbridge or something, because you could just sniff the bus after the Northbridge then. So Microsoft did a system where no encrypted or no sensitive data leaves the CPU. So no key leaves ever the CPU unencrypted. Every memory is considered as untrusted. So even if you can completely emulate the RAM and put there whatever you want, well, the CPU sees it as untrusted, will check the hash fails, and the system hangs. The encryption is actually implemented in the level 2 cache, so it's there's nearly no performance impact. Even it's a real AES which is used, but because of the structure of the cache, it can be done in parallel with the data loading, so there's nearly no performance impact on encrypted data, which is important because the gaming console, there, you pay for the speed if you develop the CPU, and you don't want to waste your speed on stupid security stuff that the game people say. Sometimes, yeah, you need to store secure data. For example, you want to revoke a system update. If you put the revocation stuff into the flash ROM as well, you could just exchange, you could read out the flash ROM before the update, after the update, and then just exchange them to downgrade again. So in order to defeat this, you need to implement on CPU storage area. So you could implement flash on the CPU, but this doesn't work too well because flash requires a special process which is too costly if you want to do it for the whole CPU. Although flash isn't one-time programmable, you can erase it and flash it, and even if you have some mechanism to disable the erasing and so on, you can still glitch a flash, and it's all not that great. So what Microsoft did was to use the eFuse technology. eFuses are electrical burnable fuses, so like some small fuses on the CPU die, and you can apply some high current to it, and it will burn, and you can sense this fuse and see that it burned. So you do, essentially, you have a one-time programmable matrix of bits which you can use for whatever you want. Microsoft uses this to revoke system updates. So if they don't want you to downgrade to a previous version of the kernel, for example, they burn a fuse and say, hey, this old version should not run anymore. And nobody is able to clear this fuse anymore because it's burned and there's no way to reconnect the fuse. It's on CPU die and not accessible from the outside. And they did that, and they had such a large number of one-time programmable bits that they could implement a very large random number per CPU, which is used as a per CPU key. So every CPU has a different key burned in, which is used to encrypt some stuff. And the nice thing is that that key never leaves the CPU. So if you get an Xbox from the store, maybe, and even if we know all the shared secrets, like we have dumped the boot ROM and all of that, and we could still not decrypt some parts of it because the key in the CPU is different for each Xbox. And they are also implemented using the eFuses because they are cheap and, yeah, the key is like 128 bits or something. So, yeah, that's not a problem. Yeah, I've spoken of the update problem. Basically, this can be set as a replay attack because you use content which is signed okay. For example, a buggy kernel was back then signed by Microsoft to be okay. It later turned out to be exploitable. Now Microsoft did an update, so the kernel doesn't work anymore. So if the hacker wants to load the old kernel again, it could just replay the old kernel, and it's signed okay. But with this sequence counting they implemented using the ifuse, I've just spoken about this, this isn't possible. So this defeats replay attack to a certain kind. Another interesting thing is how a CPU boots, because if you there must be a shared secret inside the CPU, which is used to decrypt the whole file system, the games, and so on. And you can't just use an external ROM like in a PC where you have a BIOS chip. You want to have a secure boot ROM, and it should be implemented, if possible, on the CPU. And it should be big enough to hold a decent algorithm. So on the Xbox One, they had a very tiny boot ROM implemented on a die, not even on the CPU, which made it possible to snoop it out. But they thought it would be enough to provide a secure bootloader. But they had to cram so much stuff into such a tiny area that they had to choose a very buggy hashing algorithm, which later turned out to be exploitable. So they didn't want to have that again. So what they did was to include a real boot ROM into the CPU this time. It's large enough, it's 32 kilobytes. That's enough to do some decent decryption, some decent signature checking, instead of the unproven, unstable algorithm which I used on the Xbox One. Of course, it costs a bit of money because it's die space, and die space is expensive, but it probably turned out to be worth the effort. Also, another thing which killed the original Xbox security was that the memory initialization wasn't secure. The memory initialization isn't as easy as it sounds. It's not like initialize some registers. No, this time in the times of so fast memory, it's more a brute force approach. So you try to calibrate some delays until the data matches, and it's really what's done. They are brute forcing delays and seeing when the data is okay and trying to find a window of operation and using the middle of that, then it also improves reliability. But it's quite a complicated process, and you want memory for that. For example, if you want to store the immediate results on something. The Xbox One didn't have that memory setup encrypted. It was just a series of instructions which were executed by the boot ROM. So that allowed to place some code in the external ROM, which could later run and so on. And, this wasn't a way for the Xbox 360. So what they did, they added internal RAM inside the CPU, 64 kilobyte in total, which is enough to do all kinds of thing, and you cannot mess around with the internal RAM on the CPU because, again, it's on the CPU die, and at last, for us hackers, it's not possible to mess around with that RAM. And you can use this RAM later to store the memory hashes. I've talked about the memory hashing. Those memory hashes must be stored somewhere. And if they are stored in the external RAM, you could, again, mess around with them. But if they are stored in the internal RAM, it's much more secure. So, yeah, internal RAM, again, isn't cheap, but it's possible, and it adds quite a bit of security to the system. I'm now talking a bit about the boot process of the Xbox 360. First, it's called 1BL. It's the bootloader. It's in the internal CPU ROM. It's 32 kilobytes of code, and it does it has a real algorithm for deriving the keys, a secure algorithm for deriving the keys for decryption. It uses an SHA and RC4 for that in a secure way, by the way. They're using RSA and SHA for the signature check, not the crappy TEA, which they used on the Xbox One. And they already used the memory management unit to do everything as secure as possible. They have non-execution executable code pages even at that early moment. So if you're able by whatever method to make the bootloader jump to an area where it shouldn't jump, it wouldn't execute the code there. It would only execute the code from the executable code pages, which is only the ROM. So it's much more harder to exploit that bootloader because it already uses the features of the CPU. The boot ROM essentially loads the second stage boot ROM from flash, checks the signature, and runs it then. The second stage bootloader runs from the internal RAM, and the first thing it checks is the bootloader revocation. So if a bootloader turns out to be buggy, Microsoft is able to update that bootloader and burn a fuse, and the old bootloader will check if it was revoked or not. So the bootloader includes a revocation check for itself in it. Of course, this must be done at the very early in the bootloader, because if a bug is before that revocation check, you could exploit that anyway, and it could not revoke it anymore. But it's done quite at the beginning, and yeah, that makes it quite secure. They initialize the memory. It runs in the internal RAM, so it can be done in a nice way. It initializes the external memory encryption using a real random number generator, which is on CPU die as well. So it uses a different key for the memory encryption each time. So even if you have found out the key one time, you could then modify the memory. But because the key is changing every time you boot, this isn't possible to use it on another console then or after you reboot it. Then that bootloader loads a kernel loader into external RAM. The external RAM now is already secure because the hashing is already enabled, the memory encryption is already enabled. That bootloader then loads the kernel, and then there's an interesting thing. It can execute either the kernel directly, the kernel is stored in flash ROM, and it's never updated. Instead, Microsoft is adding kernel patches to it. So if they update something in the kernel, which they do quite often, they do not rewrite the whole kernel. Instead, they add a patch, which is applied while the boot process. So the 4BL extracts the kernel into RAM, then executes all the patches which are stored in flash ROM, and then jumps to the patched kernel. Of course, all the patches have to be signed as well, so there's no easy way to attack this. The thing is, part of the revocation stuff disallows booting without any patches. So it would be, at the beginning, it was possible to erase the patches from flash and then run the old kernel, the base kernel, it's called, again. But they then burned an e-fuse, and this disallowed the possibility to run the original kernel anymore. So when there are no patches present in the flash ROM, it won't boot anymore. This is important because we can detect this later. The kernel itself includes the hypervisor in the lower 128 kilobytes of RAM. The hypervisor completely uses encrypted RAM for code and data. The kernel and the games, which are on this, which use the same security scheme, they use encrypted RAM for code, so you cannot overwrite the code with a DMA attack, for example, but they don't encrypt all the data. This is done so the data can be passed to the GPU and so on without the need to decrypt them first, and to make it easier for game developers because they don't need to say which data could be encrypted and which not. In general, all game data is not encrypted. The kernel and the hypervisor is, in fact, based on the original Xbox kernel, which in turn is based on a stripped-down Windows 2000 kernel. All the big stuff is removed. It's really just a tiny kernel anymore. It's about 1 megabyte of code. Yeah, tiny. The security itself is handled by the hypervisor. So the hypervisor checks the signature of the games, and if the signature doesn't match, it won't allow code pages to be executable. Only if the signature match, the code page flagged as executable. And the hypervisor is the only code in the system which is allowed to talk to the MMU, to configure the CPU. If you don't own the hypervisor, you cannot load code into memory. That's a fact. Hardware access, however, is not done through the hypervisor. All the games and the kernel and so on directly map the PCI registers into the addressable user space, so they just write into the registers for the GPU in Southbridge. This is not done by the hypervisor. The hypervisor is about 128 kilobytes of code. It's quite well written. It's all compiled code, but it looks very good. And yeah, there are no obvious bugs, buffer overruns or something. We searched for really a year or something for buffer overruns, and it really turned out to be well written and secure, and they used secure code practices. So yeah, but still, we hacked it. It turned out that the hypervisor wasn't that bug-free. Maybe you remember last year, we have to present our guest here. Yeah, he promised to show his face this time. I'm not sure if it worked out. Yeah. Thank you, Anonymous Hacker. You saved us the day on the last Congress. So, what did he do, the Anonymous Hacker? Basically, as I said, all the user code interacts with Mode hardware directly on the CPU internal registers, like the configuring the front side bus and all of that is handled directly in the hypervisor. User code wants to do something from the hypervisor, like to decrypt the key or decrypt data with a shared key or whatever, it executes a syscall instruction, which will enter the hypervisor. The hypervisor then will process that syscall and execute the syscall and return back. All the syscalls are done in a way that it expects the user space or the kernel space to break the rules. It does a strict check on every argument it passes. So the hypervisor tries its best to be protected from invalid arguments, from exploit possibilities. Even if you couldn't load, it's an additional layer of security. Microsoft don't expect you to be able to execute code on the system. But even if you are able to execute code in the game context, there's still the hypervisor which watches you. So if we take a look at the hypervisor syscall handler, you see the disassembly on the left side, and for those who aren't as fit in PowerPC code, there's a pseudocode on the right side. It looks quite okay. It checks the syscall number. If it's larger than an upper limit, it goes to an illegible syscall, which essentially holds the system. It will then calculate an address in a table of the syscall handlers. It will reference the table, loads the address where it jumps to. It loads the address into the link register and jumps there. So basically, it's a jump table. That code looks okay if you see it for the first time. But if we take another look, there are two instructions. The first one is compare long word immediate. So it compares a register to an immediate value. The second one is rotate left double word. It's one of the PowerPC instructions which are complicated to read. Essentially, it's a shift 2 to the left. So, yeah, what we see is one of them is named compare logical word immediate, and the other is rotate left double word by immediate. So if we add some casts in our pseudocode, we see that essentially all the registers are 64 bits, as we can see, but the compare operates, yeah, is a compare logical word immediate, not double word. We have a 64-bit PowerPC CPU. All registers are always 64-bit. There is no 32-bit mode or something. Instead, there are instructions which operate on 32-bits and some which operate on 64-bit. This is so 32-bit code just used those instructions which is available on the 32-bit subset of the architecture, and some special operations operate with a full 64-bit. The thing is, the compare logical word operates on 32 bits, the shift uses a full 64 bit. So the compare will ignore the upper 32 bits because it only operates on the lower 32 bits. The shift operation and the load operation which uses the address from the shift will not ignore those bits. So the attacker can set arbitrary upper bits in the address by setting the upper 32 bits of the past syscall number. There's something special in the 64-bit addressing on the PowerPC. The upper bit has a special meaning. Basically, if it's zero, then a special offset will be applied. This is so the hypervisor doesn't need to be at zero in memory, but you can relocate it to any memory address. The hypervisor then all use this zero-based addressing, where the most significant bit in the addresses are zero, so you can just use small addresses and don't have to load that upper bit all the time. And the CPU will apply this offset to it. So usually, the address where the syscall function pointer is loaded from is this 201C. Because the most significant bit is not set, this offset is applied, so the address in the end is 100 in the upper 32 bits and 201C in the lower bits. If we look at this, now I've already told you that the upper bits, the remaining upper bits of the address are used for security flags. So in this case, the 100 means in fact that the memory is encrypted and hashed. And the lower 32 bits are used for the physical memory address which goes to the bus, to the north bridge, and then to the memory. So the address is fetched from encrypted space at 201C. Well, if we now fill on the syscall entry the upper bit, so it gets shifted to the 8, so the most significant bit, which we can do because the compare ignores the upper bit. The LIS is a load immediate shifted, so it basically that instruction loads the upper 32 bits with the 200000. We will see that once the address is shifted in place, now the most significant bit is set, and the compare doesn't check the upper 32 bits. So the address where it loads from now doesn't have that offset applied. So it instead loads from 0000 in the upper 32 bits. So if we look again at this, the bit is not set anymore. So which means that the internal security flags are in fact not anymore encrypted and hashed. So by passing an invalid syscall number to the hypervisor, we can make it read the function address of the syscall handler from unencrypted memory. Well, actually, this is quite easy now to exploit because we can modify the memory now with a DMA attack. Before, we couldn't modify the pointer where it jumps to because it was an encrypted and hash checked memory. So if we changed something, it would just hang because of the hash check. And we couldn't put a meaningful data there anyway because it was encrypted. But now, thanks to the one in the most significant bit of the address, it is fetched from unencrypted memory. And we can use a DMA attack to write a pointer there where it jumps to. Now, retail machines still won't allow us to execute any code, not even in user mode. But there's a nice feature of the GPU. There are memory export shaders. Shaders are basically small programs that run while the 3D rendering. So there are pixel shaders, for example, which control how the pixels are shaded when they are rendered onto the screen, like a texture mapper or whatever. And on the Xbox 360, those shaders can produce data which is written to memory. This is for multipass rendering originally, but it can write anywhere in memory. Now the thing is that some games don't check their shaders when they load them. They just assume they are okay, there's no hash check. There are a lot of games which do this that way. So if we use one of those games and write a memory export shader, we can write into memory. It's basically a DMA attack. Then it's straightforward. You can overwrite the thread CPU context in memory. It's on the stack. The stack is not encrypted because it's data and no code. Again, this is all in kernel mode. But we can then make the kernel fill the syscall number with the value we want, and let the kernel call the syscall instruction by first modifying the kernel stack, then do a context restore, and then we have nearly the whole CPU context under our control. So we can make the kernel jump to the syscall with our bogus syscall number, which then does the exploit. We can, before put any pointer we want into the syscall table, which is then executed in hypervisor mode. So we use a shader which triggers the hypervisor exploit. We inject some code in the hypervisor. Normally we couldn't inject code in the hypervisor because the code would be in encrypted memory, but we can change the way, we can make a jump to any location. We can also make it to jump to a location which is not encrypted. So we let it jump to a location which is not encrypted, where we inject code before using the same DMA attack. So we wrote a second stage bootloader. We wrote a code which reads a second stage bootloader from a CD, runs that code. The code from the CD then is able to load a Linux kernel from CD. So what we needed was a Linux port. Actually, the Linux port turned out to be quite easy because other similar CPUs like the cell or the power for the servers were already supported in the kernel, so we had to add some glue code to it. Most of the peripherals in the Xbox are like in a PC. There is a PCI bus, there's an EHCI USB controller, there's serial ATA. We had to write some PCI enumeration code and that crap, but it turned out to be quite a small patch to make Linux running on the Xbox 360. We wrote drivers for the Ethernet chip, for the frame buffer driver, for the 3D. So what you get is a nice system. You've got a... So you've got a three-core machine with a PowerPC 64, for $299. So the next one is Michael wants to say something to the next picture.
Some words about how the frame buffer was implemented, the frame buffer driver for the XORG driver for the Xbox frame buffer. This is my Xbox, which was in California at that time. And Axel implemented that, who was in Japan at that time. So we hooked up a webcam. And I'll give a Snickers to the person who can recognize the four books that were very valuable to implementing this.
Yeah, okay. We will do a small demo now to show you that it's really working and it's not just some crap I've been talking. The thing is, the bootloader is a bit buggy, so it doesn't work all the time. So we might have to require a few times to make it work. I will just try it. So basically, this is an Xbox which is bought from a store. It has a hacked DVD drive, so it can run a modified copy of the game we have patched. Of course, we have the original. I really have the original. So it is one of the games. I said there are a lot of games which doesn't check. Oh, let me disable. It's one of the games which doesn't check the shaders too much. So we used King Kong. It has the shaders as a separate file on the DVD. And we put in our special shader which triggers the exploit. Then, if I now press start, the shader will load. So the game appears to be crashed. Now the drive should open in a few minutes. Yeah. In fact, the code which opens the drive is already our code running on the system. So I want to load a kernel from another disk, so I will just insert the disk again. It will now run the second stage bootloader, which then loads the Linux kernel from the CD. And this is the part which doesn't work all the time. So let's wait. Oh, yeah. actually nearly everything of the hardware except sound is working with under Linux. Sound because nobody was interested in writing a sound driver. We have SMP support for the three cores. We have a frame buffer driver, as you can see. Oh, there's no network, so it will take a moment. Yeah. And we... Yeah, the real time, there's no real time clock, so it's pretending to be 30 years ago, but let me try to fix this. Oh no. Oh, the numpad was disabled, okay. Yeah, so it's actually run GNOME on it. So we have prepared some GPU demo. We have developed a 3D driver for the GPU inside there. Okay. Nice to know. So, this is, the 3D chip running from Linux, reverse engineered the original game, and we are able to use the 3D chip in it. It's not a standard interface, but we can run some code to do some triangles and stuff. It's actually quite fast. I think this runs with a couple of 1,000 frames per second. Okay. Actually, after we published our attack, or even before, well, we talked with Microsoft about this to develop a solution which is great for everyone. Because at that time, we thought it might be a bad idea to just release an exploit because we're scared of Microsoft reactions, because we didn't know how they would react. In the end, they reacted quite good. They, they even invited us to talk about the hack at Redmond. So that's where we met the people. Sonst mach mal aus einfach. It's a journaling file system, so no worry. So what I did was to fix the exploit in the kernel by releasing a system update which used the eFuses to revoke the old kernel, which was exploitable. For a long time in the last year, it wasn't possible to use Linux on a new system. But then some clever hackers developed a process which allowed downgrading. The problem is, basically, we want to boot the old base kernel again without all those patches which patch the exploit. This isn't possible because the eFuse is burned. So let's say the sequence count is 1 and not 0 anymore because 1 eFuse is burned. And there is a section in the flash ROM which says that only if the sequence count is 0, it would run the unpatched kernel. And of course, we want to change that value. It's possible to change. However, there is also a hash stored in the flash ROM. And that hash is calculated using a secret key, which is the per CPU key. So if we don't ever run Linux on a system, we don't know the CPU key. If you run Linux, you can extract the key. But if you haven't run Linux, this is a problem. So basically, in the flash, two values are stored. First, the value we want to change, and then a hash of that value together with a secret key, which we don't know. Then the bootloader does recalculate the hash of the value stored in flash ROM with the secret and compares that to the hash which is stored in the flash ROM. You can see this in this graphic here. And if they don't compare, then it will panic and halt the system. So the conclusion is we cannot change the PD stuff, the green underlined stuff, without also recalculating the hash. And we can't recalculate the hash because we don't have the unique key for that box yet. So we cannot change the sequence counter to let us boot the exploitable kernel anymore. Well, okay, maybe we can. Because compares to memory areas, and if it encounters a byte which doesn't match, it will stop and return the difference. Now, there's a timing attack possible, because that memcompare doesn't run over all bytes if a byte is different. So if we measure the time the memcompare takes, and this is possible if we look at some data bus, then we can change the flash and look if the memcompare took longer or shorter. So what we do is to iterate through all the bytes and comparing the time which the memcompare took. There's an example at the bottom. And you can see that once a byte matches the calculated hash, which we don't know, the memcompare takes a bit longer because it has to compare one more byte. So there's some small hardware developed which can measure this time very precise. So it's in the order of microseconds. So it's measurable with normal hardware. You just need an FPGA maybe with a counter, or maybe even work with a microcontroller if you're lucky. And then iterates through all the hash values until it finds that the memcompare took longer. Then we know the byte is correct, and we do the same with the next byte. And it takes about 1 hour or something, and then we know the hash which was calculated internally. So we can now we don't need the CPU key anymore to calculate the hash. We just change the data we want, then run the timing attack, and then we know the hash 1 hour later. So that allows us to boot the base kernel again, which then allows us to upgrade to the exploitable kernel, and then we can run the King Kong exploit again, run Linux, extract the CPU key, and then we are happy. So this is what's currently possible. This is currently possible on nearly all Xboxes sold today. The really new ones, it isn't possible anymore, not because they fixed it, but because the base kernel doesn't run anymore on those hardware, because they've got a new CPU, the 65 nanometer version, and more importantly, they've got a new GPU, which has a different revision ID. So the old kernel doesn't run on that hardware anymore. That's the only problem. Yeah, I think, Ben, are you there? Oh, there. Okay. Sorry. Ben wants to talk a bit about the Wii. We had some recent discoveries in the Wii, and Ben wants to say some things about it. And it's maybe a nice comparison to the Xbox because it uses quite a different security concept. And if it worked out or not, Ben will say something.
Is this microphone on? Maybe not.
I don't think so.
Hi there.
All right, so I have been playing around, I and some friends have been playing around with this Wii here for a little bit, and they actually, it's a pretty neat, nice little system. It's a little bit smaller than the Xbox 360 there. It doesn't have nearly as nice a hardware. It's basically an improved GameCube. They made some smart decisions. They upped the processor by a little bit. They beefed up the graphics hardware. And mainly they just added some new devices like the Bluetooth controller, internal Wi-Fi that allows, you know, you have the Neat controller and some other stuff. So they did some things and they came up with some nice ideas for ways to make better games. And, you know, I think it's to their credit that it's still very hard to buy a new one of these, you know. They're very hard to find in the store. So they seem to have done well enough even with a stripped-down, minimal hardware approach. So one of the challenges they had in making this system work is that they wanted to preserve full backward compatibility with GameCube games, which on a superficial level is easy because it uses the same processor, just a little bit faster. But also, there were a number of other issues with, you know, if we have this extra hardware, we'll confuse it. So their solution to this was The processor used in both the GameCube and in the Wii is a modified, or it's almost off-the-shelf IBM PowerPC processor. The one in the Wii is called the Broadway. And there has, next to it, it has an ATI developer graphics chip, which they call the Hollywood. And that, it turns out, actually is a very interesting chip because it has what Nintendo refers to as an I/O processor bridge in it, but it's actually a full-fledged embedded ARM core that we've nicknamed the Starlet as part of Hollywood, you know. So that actually it does a lot of the authentication and all the checks and all the gatekeeping. And so this device is the gatekeeper through which all of the neat stuff like USB, Bluetooth, Wi-Fi is done. And so what happens is this chip checks. And it sits in between the DVD drive and the rest of the system, and when it detects that you're trying to boot a GameCube game, it more or less shuts itself off. It shuts off all the interesting hardware. It restricts the area of memory that you're allowed to access. And so you can run your old GameCube games, which aren't encrypted and don't have much protection, and it works out fine. You can run GameCube Linux on it, but you don't get any of the neat new Wii features. You've got a GameCube. So one of the things that they didn't do is they don't have this whole encrypted memory scheme. And so what we were able to do is do what we call a tweezer attack, where one of the restrictions they put in to keep something like this from happening is this chip is a gatekeeper between the processor and the memory, and it only lets the processor see, you know, like the lower 1/8 page of the memory, because that's all that the GameCube had. The Wii has more memory, and in that memory there are fun things like encryption and decryption keys. But you can't see them because you can't get to that memory. Well, if you manage to tie two of the address lines together for a brief moment and then have it try to read the memory, it turns out you can actually read all of the memory with a few little maneuvering. So we were able to do that and then hook up a serial line to one of the controller ports and dump a bunch of data out and parse through it or whatever. And so with that, we were able to recover some encryption keys. And so then I think I have something I can show, hopefully. So this is something, this is hot off the presses. This first worked about an hour ago, so hopefully it'll still work. Thank you. This is harder than it looks, right? This is not really Lego Star Wars, but right now we're still basically patching other code we found. Someday we'll have a nice, you know, Linux bootable DVD, but until that point, all I can show is that we do have code running. It is running in Wii mode, not GameCube mode, because we do actually have access to all the hardware. So this is something that it certainly was not all me, but I'm the only one here to actually present about it. We hope to have a release sometime soon, but not yet. It's still very, very rough. Like I said, I don't even have any slides, so we didn't think it was going to work. But it did work the last minute, so we thought we'd stand up and show this is what happens if you don't have encrypted memory. So.
Yeah, thank you guys for watching us. And yeah, that's it. Are there any questions? But I think we're quite late, so maybe if somebody wants to talk with us, we are downstairs in the Hack Center. I think you can't miss the Xboxes. So just go there and ask us. I think it's better than asking it here. I'm sorry that we are over our schedule again. So we will now go away here to make place for the next presenters.